Why don't you make believe that there's nobody else in the room and do your best 30-second warm-up. Good, are you ready? Fantastic. This is the solo de concours of Messager, and we can talk more about the piece later. Why don't we just get right into the playing?
Thank you.
that won't take long to get to the end, so let's do the just the okay. The return and the coda, and then we'll talk. Harrison, that's very good.
Thank you.
So I see you play in the PYP.
Yes.
Great. So you play a lot of different kinds of music.
Especially this year, we've been doing a lot of different kind of jazz or contemporary music, which is pretty interesting.
Have you been able to meet together, or are you doing everything online?
Everything's been online, but hopefully we'll be together next year.
Fantastic. I mean, that we'll be getting back together and doing things in person again. I think this is the first, this is the first masterclass I've done that hasn't been online this year. It's really nice to hear you in person. So, I had a chance now to hear your very impressive abilities on the clarinet. You really get around the instrument beautifully. And we can talk a little bit about sound and phrasing if for right now. This opening, I think there are some clues that you could pay more attention to. Just the fact that he writes in cut time and not in 4/4, so that you don't have to have such strong beats throughout the bar, but more of a even one to the bar would help with the trajectory. It would be easier to hear if we had the piano part, but the phrases are pretty clearly constructed with direction to the third bar of the four-bar phrase, kind of and then the end of the fourth bar is going to the next phrase. So if you would just from the first part try to emphasize the beginnings of the bars and not accent the middle, so it doesn't become or play once, okay? Get a good breath and Try to think of your destination as being the third bar. Yeah. See, to my ear, the destination sounded like the middle of the third bar. And it's a stronger note, and it's going to come out unless you really show. To the downbeat. Yeah. So now just think the phrase and play one note. Get a really good breath. Look at the music, but just play the G. Paint that sound picture with what you do with the wind. Keep it moving. But just play one note. Make sure you get a good breath first. That's the idea. Now even more. Exaggerate. Yeah. Try to keep the airstream moving while you do it. And as you get a little louder and more intense, put more air through the instrument, but always keep the air moving quickly. You know, it's like a violinist's bow. If it slows down, the quality of the sound changes. So keep it moving, keep the pressure even, and then start with that. So then everything else is layered on top of that. That's the foundation of the phrase you're making. Good breath, and that same long tone again. Okay, now try to make that same air stream shape, intensity, volume, and move your fingers to make the notes of the phrase. Da, just play ba pa pa pum, ba pa pa pum. The G's not as important, I think. You arrive at the chord that starts on the beginning of the bar. So that the shape of the, you know, you could argue that that the phrase is a different shape, but for right now, let's agree that that's our goal. And then you're going to have to really make sure that you lead to that third measure. Yeah. See, to me, that sounds like you really had an idea of what you were going to do, which, of course, we agreed on in advance, and you executed it, and I could hear it. Now do the next phrase like that. Yeah, so I think if you were playing a long tone on that, it might sound a little... I really want to hear that consistency. Moving. Keep the bow moving. Yeah, I'll take that. Good. Then he gets fancy, right? Let's hear the next section with the triplets. Some of the time is when the notes get more complicated. You've trained your fingers to do it really quite well, but something shuts down a little bit with your tone production and you're not using the same kind of consistency of airflow. So just get a big breath right now, and should we do the, let's do the long tone and just think of the triplets. Building, right? So, keep the air moving. Just play that G and think the moving notes. as simple as just doing that and moving your fingers, because there's a certain amount of voicing that will help get over the high notes. But believe me, if you are supporting the air stream, getting a good breath and keeping it moving, everything else is much, much easier, and adjustments and voicing are more subtle than you probably need to do right now. So support, get a big, big breath, and play that measure, with the goal being that you're going to keep the air moving and play those triplets very cleanly. I don't want to turn your life upside down by talking about too many physical things, but I'm going to ask you, in terms of reeds that you use generally, is this on the hard side, the soft side? Is it perfect? Is it your favorite reed, or are you struggling? Or
this is slightly on the slightly on the soft side.
And that does affect the high register, but I might suggest. Is that a BD5 Phantom or something like that? It is a BD5. Good, so you can get a fair amount of resistance from that, a good resistance that you can play against and get a lot of sound. But I know how much those cost, right? And my suggestion is to use the whole facing that came with the mouthpiece for that price. It's a joke. But look sideways at the light, and if you can see where the reed leaves the mouthpiece, and that's the length of the facing. And if you keep your lower lip at or below where the reed leaves the facing on the mouthpiece, you'll have a little more resistance to blow against in the high register, and it'll be more stable when you go up there. Try doing that without changing anything else, and just play from this pickup, this scale, going up over in the high register. Good. So it's a little more even sound, but what happens when you do that, like when you go down, I call it the fulcrum, where the flat reed leaves the curved facing. If you're going further down like that, then what happens is you're opening everything up, and your vowel position of your throat becomes more of a oo than an e, or even close to the o, and then it becomes a little diffused in the upper register, although the notes come out easier. Closer to an EU position, European Union. As opposed to, it's a little out of control. And all you need to do is just vocalize a little bit closer to keeping the airstream smaller, which I think the default position would be that, like an umlaut in German, or EU in French, or even in English, more of an U, so it's further forward. And just those two things, getting the whole facing of your mouthpiece engaged for the reed to vibrate easily, and focusing the size of the airstream, can clear up that high register. So, would you play again from that same scale? Yeah, try it again. Keep your chin really flat. Stay stay down at the fulcrum, and maybe even experiment with an even smaller not all the way to E, but a little more forward. Yeah, and then make sure you coordinate your fingers between notes when you're coming from the high register down, and keep the air moving so that there's no hesitation between notes. Do you know what I mean? You're kind of a, you know, there's a little hesitation, and it could be because you're not coordinating putting this finger down and these up precisely at the same moment, and it could be because you're not moving the wind, because you habitually, you know that there's a little hiccup between those notes, so you stop blowing as much, and so it's one or the other is the cause. But if you practice it slowly, exaggerate those tendencies even slightly more. Get a good breath, play it up to tempo, but really focus the stream. Good. So, is it getting dark out? I'd love to work with you more, but I think there are three other people planning to play. And you play so well. Thank you for coming. Thank you.